The attack on the US consulate in Benghazi was striking for a number of reasons. The date, for starters, September the 11th. Then there was the toll, 4 Americans dead. This was an attack that went on for 2 hours, and when it was over, Chris Stevens, the US ambassador to Libya, was dead, and his mission was in full retreat.
Mr. Hicks, when you arrived in July, did the facilities in Benghazi meet the minimum OSPB security standards set by the State Department?
According to the regional security officer at the time in Tripoli, John Martinek, they did not.
What about the facilities in Tripoli? The Benghazi facilities did not meet the minimum standards of the facilities in Tripoli?
Again, according to the regional security officer in Tripoli, John Martinek, they were very weak, yes. They did not meet.
They did not meet. Do you think they were close to meeting the standards?
No, sir.
Mr. Nordstrom, before you left as the RSO, did the facilities have the number of security personnel that you had requested?
No, they did not.
In fact, my understanding, Mr. Hicks, is that it reached such a point of vulnerability that you actually approached some of the diplomatic security and asked for the diplomats to be trained in how to handle a gun, because there was such a fear of the people on the ground because you were so exposed. Is that true?
That's true.
This emergency meeting in Benghazi less than a month before the attack, at that briefing, the people are told that there are 10 Islamist militias and Al-Qaeda groups in Benghazi. The consulate cannot sustain a coordinated attack and that they need extra help. And this information goes directly to the office of the Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton.
Rating level assigned for threat categories for our various posts, and there are 4 of them: critical, high, medium, and low. And we have 264 posts that where we had security concerns, overseas diplomatic posts at the time of Benghazi. There were 14 posts rated as either high or critical, not a huge number, but 14. Two of the posts were Benghazi and Tripoli. It's not like they had this incredible array of posts that were on this high alert. Embassy Tripoli, this is from the report, did not demonstrate strong and sustained advocacy with Washington for increased security for a special mission Benghazi. And yet, we've heard your predecessor, Mr. Hicks, pleaded for additional help. You pleaded for it. It's documented, and you didn't get it. You actually got a reduction. Is that correct, as was pointed out?
Yes, yeah. A drastic reduction.
Mr. Nordstrom, you testified in October. There were 200 and some security incidences in Libya the 13 months prior to the attack. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Repeated attempts to breach the facility there. You repeatedly asked for additional security personnel, and it was denied, correct?
That's correct.
Not only denied, but it was reduced, correct?
That's correct.
Andrew Wood is a highly decorated Special Forces Green Beret with counterterrorism expertise who headed a 16-member security team in Libya. He met daily with U.S. Ambassador Christopher Stevens. Wood says the State Department initiated an ill-advised drawdown of security in the 6 months before the assault. 1 month before the attack, Wood's military team and the last of 3 SWAT-style State Department teams left Libya.
When you found out the last 2 teams were being pulled from Libya, what was your feeling about that?
I felt like we were being asked to play the piano with 2 fingers. There was concern amongst the entire embassy staff. I had people come and asking me that as well.
What were they saying?
I didn't feel good about it. They asked if we were safe. They asked what was going to happen. And I could only answer that what we were being told was they're working on it. They'll get us more, but I never saw that.
Ambassador Stevens wanted continued or enhanced security. The regional security officer wanted enhanced or continued security.
Yes.
You wanted enhanced or continued security.
Yes.
There was a consensus on the ground.
For enhanced or continued in security that we had known, that we had come to live with and work with there, for the environment we had, we felt we needed more, not less.
So all the experts on the ground are telling headquarters of the State Department, we need this. And the answer kept coming back as,
you've got to do with less. For what reasons, I don't know.
3:40 p.m. in Washington, D.C., 9:40 Benghazi time, terrorists attack the U.S. mission in Benghazi. 3:50, 9:50 p.m. Benghazi time, Ambassador Chris Stevens frantically calls his deputy Greg Hicks in Tripoli, saying, "Greg, we are under attack." His local Libyan security deserts him as attackers swarm the compound, as surviving State Department personnel try bravely but in vain to save the ambassador and colleague Sean Smith. 4:05 p.m., 20 minutes after Stevens' last message, the president, while visiting wounded warriors at Walter Reed, is informed of the attack. 4:40 p.m., the president departs Bethesda, Maryland on Marine One, landing on the South Lawn at 4:50 p.m. At 5 that evening, 11 p.m. Benghazi time, outgoing Defense Secretary Panetta and General Martin Dempsey, chairman of the Joint Chiefs, meet for 30 minutes with the president at the White House.
Time we had, we were concerned about Cairo and demonstrations in Cairo, and then we had just picked up the information that that something was happening, that there was an apparent attack going on in Benghazi. And I informed the president of that fact, and he at that point directed both myself and General Dempsey to do everything we needed to do to try to protect lives there.
Did he ask you how long it would take to deploy assets, including armed aviation, to the area?
He basically said, do whatever you need to do to be able to protect our people there.
Mr. Hicks, did the embassy have a defense attaché on staff whose role it was to interface with the Defense Department? And did you ask him that evening, were there any resources coming from the U.S. Military? And what was your reaction to his responses as the evening unfolded?
My reaction was that, okay, we're on our own. We're going to have to try to pull this off with the resources that we have available.
Were the Libyans surprised?
I don't know, but I think they were.
Did you have any, so he didn't ask you what ability we had in the area and what we could do?
No, he relied on both myself as secretary and on General Dempsey's capabilities. He knows generally what we've deployed into the region. We've presented that to him in other briefings. So he knew generally what was deployed out there. But as to specifics about time, et cetera, no, he just left that up to us.
Did you have any further communications with him that night?
No.
Did you have any other further communications? Did he ever call you that night to say, how are things going? What's going on? Where's the consulate?
No, but we were aware that as we were getting information on what was taking place there, particularly when we got information that the ambassador, his life had been lost, we were aware that that information went to the White House.
10 p.m., 4 a.m. Benghazi time, the president, in regular communication with his national security team, speaks for the first time directly with Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, who sometime during the evening has released a statement saying, "I condemn in strongest terms the attack on our mission in Benghazi." Her statement goes on to say, quote, "Some have sought to justify this vicious behavior as a response to the inflammatory material posted on the internet. The United States deplores any international effort to denigrate the religious beliefs of others," end quote.
Was there any evidence in when you were there in Libya on that day that this was a protest?
No, there was none. And I'm confident that Ambassador Stevens would have reported a protest immediately if one appeared on his door. The protocol, of course, was for us to evacuate immediately from the consulate and moved to the annex.
Okay. Was there anything in connection to a YouTube video? Was there any awareness that it was the events occurred because of a YouTube video?
The YouTube video was a non-event in Libya.
Okay. And did you know about that within a couple days or the day of?
Yes.
Okay.
An hour later, 11:15 p.m., 5:15 a.m. in Benghazi, and less than 15 minutes after a rescue team arrived on scene from Tripoli, former SEALs Ty Woods and Glenn Dougherty are killed in a mortar attack on the CIA annex.
Mr. Hicks, I want to go back to that first plane from Tripoli. It went from Tripoli as the noted in the ARB report, included 7 rescue team members, including two U.S. military personnel. That plane then returns to Tripoli, and the first rescue team that is there is now really engaged in the attack. You have no idea, my understanding, as to when the attack is going to end. So the second rescue team is preparing to go. And I want you mentioned it in your opening statement, but if you could please go back to what this second team, now the second team included 4 U.S. military. These are highly trained special forces personnel, one of which is a medic. And yet these military personnel do not operate under your authority, and your permission is not enough for them to go. Explain to me again exactly what happened.
Again, we determined that we needed to send second team from Tripoli to secure the airport for the withdrawal of our personnel from Benghazi after the mortar attack.
But were any of these U.S. military personnel not permitted to travel on a rescue mission or relief mission to Benghazi?
They were not authorized to travel.
Did you communicate with anyone else at the White House that night?
No.
No one else called you to say, how are things going?
No.
Okay.
How did the personnel react to being told to stand down?
They were furious. I can only say, well, I will quote Lieutenant Colonel Gibson. He said, this is the first time in my career that a diplomat has more balls than somebody in the military.
But just to be clear, that night he didn't ask you what assets we had available and how quickly they could respond and what we could do to help those individuals there.
I think the biggest problem that night, Senator, was that nobody knew really what was going on there.
And there was no follow-up during the night, at least from the White House directly?
No, there wasn't.
That is the last communication between the commander-in-chief and his top military officials on the night of the attack.
Is there any reason to believe that the situation in Benghazi was over? I mean, there were a number of series of attacks that you've described to us. Any reason to believe that that there was no longer any danger in Benghazi?
No, there was every reason to continue to believe that our personnel were in danger.
Let me say a couple of things. First of all, we are obviously closely monitoring developments in the region today. You saw that following the incidents in response to this video, the president directed the administration to take a number of steps to prepare for continued unrest.
And I want to ask you about one lingering question, which is the president's actions on 9/11, the night of the attack, because we don't know very much about that. We do know that in the afternoon, he had an already scheduled meeting with Defense Secretary Panetta, as well as the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, General Martin Dempsey. When he heard about this while they were in a meeting on an unrelated subject, he said that he wanted them to deploy forces as soon as possible. The next time that he shows up is that Hillary Clinton says that she spoke to him at around 10 o'clock that night after the attack at the consulate, not as it turned out at the annex, but the attack at the consulate had ended. Question, what did the president do the rest of that night to pursue Benghazi?
He was in constant touch that night with his national security team and kept up to date as the events as they were happening.
Well, you say his national security team, he didn't talk to the Secretary of State except for the one time when the first attack was over. He didn't talk to the Secretary of Defense. He didn't talk to the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs. Who was he talking to?
He was talking to his national security staff, his national security council, or the people who would keep him up to date about these things as they happen.
Was he in the Situation Room?
He was kept up to date throughout the day.
Do you not know whether he was in the Situation
Room? I don't remember what room the president was in on that night, and that's a largely irrelevant fact.
The ambassador goes missing. It ends up the first ambassador in more than 30 years is killed. 4 Americans, including the ambassador, are killed. Dozens of Americans are in jeopardy. The president at 4 o'clock in the afternoon says to the chairman of the Joint Chiefs, deploy forces. No forces are deployed. Where is he while all this is going on?
Major Robert Furman, a Pentagon spokesman, said there was never any kind of stand down order to anybody. And that's a pretty broad statement, anybody. What's your reaction to the quote by Mr. Furman?
I can only again repeat that Lieutenant Colonel Gibson said he was not to proceed to board the airplane.
So your firsthand experience being on the site, standing next to Colonel Gibson, who was on his way on that C-130 transport, and being told not to go, contradicts what Mr. Furman is saying on behalf of the Pentagon.
Yes, sir.
12:30 a.m. September 12th, 6:30 a.m. Benghazi time, escorted by friendly Libyan forces, all U.S. government personnel are evacuated from the annex to the Benghazi airport. 10:46 a.m., about an hour later, the president speaks from the Rose Garden.
Since our founding, the United States has been a nation that respects all faiths. We reject all efforts to denigrate the religious beliefs of others.
2:20 p.m., the president departs Andrews Air Force Base en route to Las Vegas, Nevada, for a scheduled fundraiser. Critics are horrified by the insensitivity the move shows.
The facility was attacked. Four Americans were killed. The president took immediate action to ensure that our diplomats and diplomatic facilities around the world were reinforced and secured as necessary, that everything was done that could be done to provide assistance to our personnel in Benghazi and in Tripoli.
Mr. Hicks, who is Beth Jones?
Beth Jones is the Acting Assistant Secretary for Near Eastern Affairs at the State Department.
I want to read an excerpt from an email she sent to you, to counsel for Hillary Clinton, to Victoria Nuland, to Mr. Kennedy, near as I can tell, to almost everyone in the State Department, and I'm going to read from it. I spoke to the Libyan ambassador and emphasized the importance of Libyan leaders continuing to make strong statements. By the way, Mr. Hicks, this email was sent on September the 12th. And I'll continue. When he said his government suspected that former Gaddafi regime elements carried out the attacks, I told him that the group that conducted the attacks, Ansar al-Sharia, is affiliated with Islamic terrorists. Let me say that again, Mr. Hicks. She told him, the State Department is telling the ambassador to Libya, the group that conducted the attacks, Ansar al-Sharia, is affiliated with Islamic terrorists.
Let me state very clearly, and I hope it is obvious, that the United States government had absolutely nothing to do with this video.
This is the first version of the Benghazi talking points produced by the CIA at 2:27 p.m. on September 14, 2012. It says that the Benghazi assault may have been, quote, spontaneously inspired by the protests at the U.S. Embassy in Cairo and evolved into a direct assault against the U.S. consulate. It also said, quote, we know that Islamic extremists with ties to al-Qaeda participated in the attack. It also cites at least five other attacks against foreign interests in Benghazi, and that we cannot rule out that individuals had previously surveilled the U.S. facilities.
And that same day at 7:39 from Victoria, that one says in part, and the penultimate point could be abused by members to beat members, meaning members of Congress, to beat the State Department for not paying attention to agency warnings. So why do we want to feed that either? Concerned, dot, dot, dot. So this doesn't seem to be talking about, you know, was it an attack? Was it an assault? Was it a protest? Was it a demonstration? Who was responsible? But trying to make sure that the Department of State was being protected based on what was going to be provided in talking points.
We've seen rage and violence directed at American embassies over an awful internet video that we had nothing to do with.
Here's one of the reasons that people have questions about this. This week, the White House released 100 pages of emails, all the communications between the various agencies in the 2 days before Susan Rice came on this and four other Sunday talk shows. I just want to put up a couple of the emails from the two from Friday. Mm-hmm. Friday the 14th, 2 days before Susan Rice made her television appearance. Friday, 6:48 p.m., Tommy Vietor in the White House. FYI, Brennan, that's the president's counterterrorism advisor, will have edits. I'm waiting for those.
According to the emails and the timeline, sure. The CIA circulates new talking points after they've removed a mention of al-Qaeda.
Yeah.
And then at 6:21, the White House, you,
me,
add a line about the administration warning of September 10th of social media reports calling for demonstrations. True?
I believe so.
Did you also change attacks to demonstrations in the talking points?
Maybe. I don't really remember.
You don't remember?
Dude, this was like 2 years ago. We're still talking about the
Dude,
most mundane process.
It is the thing that everybody is talking about.
But in, again, in the totality of looking at all the information that's been provided to this committee, We see the State Department trying to backtrack or cover themselves from not paying attention to warnings. The follow on email was from David Adams. I'm with Toria, referring to Ms. Newland. The last bullet is especially will read to members like we had been repeatedly warned. Followed on, I spoke with Tommy. We'll work with this in the morning, get comments back.
The final version, after numerous revisions, produced at 12:13 p.m. on September 15th, kept the concept of a spontaneous demonstration, but removed references to al-Qaeda or affiliated groups, previous attacks on diplomatic facilities, or the possibility of premeditated surveillance. This page shows how much of it happened. Handwritten changes ordered by Deputy CIA Director Michael Morell after a White House meeting September 15th. Top CIA officials told us Morell's changes coincidentally reflected those expressed by top State Department officials.
Here's what the president's spokesman, Jake Carney, said about all of this last November. Take a look.
The White House and State Department have made clear that the single adjustment that was made to those talking points by either of those two of these two institutions were changing the word consulate to diplomatic facility because consulate was inaccurate.
That's the problem. He says there was a single adjustment by the White House and State. Any fair reading of the emails, just the two I read, that's totally misleading.
And you believe that this was the work of al-Qaeda? And you believe that it was led by foreigners. Is that what you're telling us?
It was planned, definitely it was planned by foreigners, by people who entered the country a few months ago. And they were planning this criminal act since their arrival.
Madam Ambassador, he says that this is something that's been in the planning stages for months. I understand you have been saying that you think it was spontaneous. Are we not on the same page here?
Well, Bob, let me tell you what we understand to be the assessment at present. First of all, very importantly, as you discussed with the president, there is a investigation that the United States government will launch led by the FBI that has begun.
But and they're not there.
They're not on the ground yet, but they have already begun looking at all sorts of evidence of various sorts already available to them and to us. And they will get on the ground and continue the investigation. So we'll want to see the results of that investigation to draw any definitive conclusions. But based on the best information we have to date, what our assessment is as of the present is in fact what it began spontaneously in Benghazi as a reaction to what had transpired some hours earlier in Cairo, where of course, as you know, there was a violent protest outside of our embassy sparked by this hateful video.
Would you call the attack on the U.S. consulate in Benghazi an act of terrorism?
I have no doubt about that. And it's a pre-planned act of terrorism directed against American citizens.
This was a pre-planned attack, not
no doubt.
In reaction to a controversial movie?
Yes, I have no doubt about this.
Do you think the movie had anything to do
of
with
course.
This attack on the consulate?
Not on this attack. Not on this attack. It has nothing to do with this attack.
Would you have said the things that Ambassador Rice said?
Not after hearing what President Magariaf said, especially considering the fact that he had gone to Libya, to Benghazi himself at great personal and political risk. And for him to appear on world television and say this was a planned attack is by terrorists is phenomenal. I was jumping up and down when he said that. It was a gift for us from a policy perspective, from my perspective, sitting in Tripoli.
And did that occur before September 16th?
He said that on the same talk shows with Ambassador Rice.
And did you report that? Was there knowledge that he was going to say that?
No, there was not.
And now in Washington today, the White House was feeling the heat because of a new twist in the fiery debate over Benghazi, the attack on the U.S. consulate that killed four Americans. A new email seems to call into question what the White House said about its role. And ABC's chief White House correspondent Jonathan Carl was there asking the questions. 18
18 months after the terrorist attack in Benghazi, Libya that killed four Americans, newly released emails suggest the White House blamed the attacks on an anti-Islamic video in order to deflect criticism of the president's policies. The previously secret White House email lists top goals for Ambassador Susan Rice as she prepared for a now infamous round of interviews just days after the attacks, saying she should, quote, underscore these protests are rooted in an internet video and not a broader failure of policy. The White House has long insisted Rice's talking points came from the intelligence community, but the email is written by a top political aide, and the former CIA director recently told Congress the intelligence community didn't agree with what Rice said.
When she talked about the video, my reaction was that's not something that the analysts have attributed this attack to.
When you finally read Ambassador Rice's Sunday morning talk show transcripts or however you found out finally about it, did you complain to the White House at all about what she was saying, or were you comfortable with what she said?
I did not complain to anybody, sir.
The White House insists the email doesn't change the story at all, but it was only released in response to a lawsuit demanding all Benghazi-related emails.
Why were you holding back this information? Why was this email not turned over to the Congress? This is directly relevant. Why did you hold it back?
John, again.
Why did it take a court case for you to release this email?
John, I can say it again and again, and I know you can keep asking again and again. This document was not about Benghazi.
That's right. The White House says it didn't initially release the email because it was about broader unrest in the Arab world and not Benghazi specifically.
Kinzinger, thanks a lot for coming on this morning.
Yeah.
So recap the scene. This is right after Benghazi. It's behind closed doors. The Secretary of State, then Hillary Clinton, meeting with members of Congress. Someone suggests it's a terror attack, and she says...
Yeah, basically in a very loud, angry voice says it's irresponsible to even suggest this is a terror attack. This is a YouTube video. We know that there are protests all over, and we need to be very careful in how we're saying this, and basically chided this member of Congress. And it was really I actually sat there in that meeting and believed, well, the secretary actually believes this is a YouTube video because of how passionately she's arguing it.
They were doing what they were doing.
No.
We
were misled that there were supposedly protests and then something sprang out of that, an assault sprang out of that. And that was easily ascertained that was not the fact.
But the American
people could have known that within days, and they didn't know that.
With all due respect, the fact is we had four dead Americans. Was it because of a protest, or was it because of guys out for a walk one night who decided they'd go kill some Americans? What difference at this point does it make?
You got a phone. Isn't it true, Mr. Hicks? I think you cited this in your opening statement. The Secretary Clinton gave you a call immediately after the attacks and said you did an outstanding job under extreme circumstances?
Yes, sir. We had the first call at 2 a.m. and then again a video conference with our staff.
And isn't it also true the President of the United States called you up and said, you know what, Mr. Hicks, you did an outstanding job again under severe circumstances?
He did call me, sir.
And all that seems to change. You're getting all this praise and support, but all that seems to change, and it seems to change in the phone call you were on that Mr. Gowdy referenced in his questioning, the phone call you got from Beth Jones. Is that accurate?
Yes, in a phone call after the interview, I asked.
This is after Secretary Rice has went on television and misled the American people. You're on a phone call with Beth Jones, and it all seems to change then because you asked you asked Beth Jones what?
I asked her why the ambassador had said there was a demonstration when the embassy had reported only an attack.
And again, what kind of response did you get from Beth Jones when you asked that question?
She said, I don't know.
Was it like, you shouldn't be asking that question, you should be quiet, we don't want to talk about that? What was the sense you got?
The sense I got was that I needed to stop the line of questioning.
That she knew all along was a terror attack, is that your belief? And that she did not tell absolutely. You the truth? Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if you even look at the emails that were exchanged during this, they called it basically a terrorist attack. They knew what was going on. And as was famously said by Senator McCain, you don't bring, mortars to a YouTube video demonstration. This was planned for a very long time. They knew it. And for whatever reason, they wanted to say at the end, this was not an act of terror. This was just a spontaneous demonstration. And it's irresponsible.
So do you think that reason might be related to the fact there was a presidential campaign and the president wanted people to believe that he had Al-Qaeda under control?
Yeah, it's absolutely right. I mean, the whole theory was, hey, we're getting out of Iraq, we're getting out of Afghanistan. You know, Al-Qaeda might have chosen the beginning of this war, but we've chosen the ending, and it happens to be a couple months before the election. And what we've seen is when America retreats from the world and its leadership retreats from the world, chaos fills that vacuum. And the president didn't want to admit it. He didn't want to say it. He was more interested in getting through November. That's my belief.
Were there other people, other lawmakers in that room? And if so, why are you the only one to come forward with this?
Well, there were a lot of lawmakers in that room. In fact, I'd say most of them. I actually think a while ago I've heard people say that that happened. It's just the mainstream media never picked up on it. And it's not until I mentioned this at a town hall meeting that people really opened their eyes and said, okay, now we know that, in fact, they knew it was a terrorist attack and this was the case. I mean, I don't care about the yelling so much, she yelled, but I care more about the fact that this was a terrorist attack. And a member of Congress who has a right to know this and ask these questions was chided for even saying what we eventually found out is the truth.
So that's for certain. So who was this member of Congress she barked at?
I don't want to say it because it was behind closed doors. I'll let the member come forward themselves. But I will say there were plenty of witnesses to this. And again, this was just a shame and a sad thing to happen.
And did things continue to deteriorate between you and your superiors? After they've given you all this praise, you've had this outstanding service record, 22 years serving our country, things began to deteriorate even more. And as I read the transcript, it seems to me that it came to a head in phone calls you were on with lawyers from the Department of State prior to Congressman Chaffetz coming to visit in Libya. Is that accurate?
Yes, sir.
And tell me about those conversations, what those lawyers instructed you to do on Mr. Chaffetz's visit to Libya.
I was instructed not to allow the RSO, the acting deputy chief of mission, and myself to be personally interviewed by Congressman Chaffetz.
So the people at state told you don't talk to the guy who's coming to investigate?
Yes, sir.
Said don't not talk with personally. The congressman? Now, you've had several congressional delegations come to various places you've been around the world. Has that ever happened where lawyers get on the phone to you prior to a congressional delegation coming to investigate a time when we've had four Americans lose their lives? Have you ever had anyone tell you don't talk with the people from Congress coming to find out what took place?
Never.
Never. And you've had dozens and dozens of congressional delegations that you've been a part of.
Yes, sir.
First time it's ever happened.
Yes, sir.
Tell me about, and also, isn't it true that one of those lawyers on the phone call accompanied the folks on the delegation and tried to be in every single meeting you had with Mr. Chaffetz and the delegation from this committee?
Yes, sir. That's true.
Tell me what happened when you got a classified briefing with Mr. Chaffetz. What happened and the phone call that happened after that?
The lawyer was excluded from the meeting because his clearance was not high enough, and the delegation had insisted that the briefing not be limited by any...
Did the lawyer try to get in that briefing?
He tried, yes, but the annex chief and would not allow it because the briefing needed to be at the appropriate level of clearance.
And you had a subsequent conversation after this classified briefing that the lawyer was not allowed to be in. You and Mr. Chaffetz and others on that delegation. You had another conversation on the phone with Cheryl Mills. Tell me, who is Cheryl Mills?
She was counselor for the Department of State and chief of staff to Secretary Clinton.
That's a pretty important position?
Yes, sir.
When she calls, you take the phone call?
Immediately.
Yeah, she's the fixer for the Secretary of State. She is as close as you can get to Secretary Clinton. Is that accurate?
Yes, sir.
And tell me about that phone call you had with Cheryl Mills.
She demanded a report on the visit.
Was she upset by the fact that this lawyer was not, this
was upset.
Babysitter, this spy, whatever you want to call him, was not allowed to be in that? First time it's ever happened, all the congressional delegations you've ever entertained was not allowed to be in that classified briefing. Was she upset about that fact?
She was very upset.
So this goes right to the person next to Secretary Clinton. Is that accurate?
Yes, sir.
Let me begin by asking you whether you would say that Ambassador Stevens and the three other Americans died as a result of a terrorist attack.
Certainly on that particular question, I would say yes. They were killed in the course of a terrorist attack on our embassy.
It is, I think, self-evident that what happened in Benghazi was a terrorist attack. Our embassy was attacked violently, and the result was four deaths of American officials.
You've got a new tower across the New York skyline.
Al-Qaeda's on the path to defeat. Bin Laden is dead.
I think it's fair to say that Al-Qaeda, you know, continues, as I've indicated, to try to pursue its efforts in that part of the world. We've been going after them in Yemen. We've been going after them in Somalia. We've been going after them in North Africa. And that because they continue to be a threat in those areas. And, you know, again, they continue to operate in different ways as well in other parts of Africa. As to specifically whether they were or were not involved with regards to the attack in Benghazi, I think that remains for the investigation to determine.
But the fact is that administration officials are now calling this a terrorist attack.
It was a terrorist attack.
Did you ever question officials in Washington about what Secretary Rice said on Sunday, the Sunday talk shows?
Yes. Again, when Assistant Secretary Jones called me after the talk show event, I asked her why she had said there was a demonstration when we had reported it, that there was an attack.
Was she the only one that you talked about?
Talked
to? Okay. And her reaction was?
Her reaction again was, I don't know, and it was very clear that from the tone that I should not proceed with any further.
So she was very curt?
Yes.
Okay. Did you receive any negative feedback based on this conversation?
Over the next month, I began to receive counseling from Assistant Secretary Jones about my management style, things that I basically was already doing on the ground, but nevertheless, I implemented everything that she asked me to do.
Something that you were highly recommended and highly accommodated for, they're questioning all of a sudden. Can I have the video to be played on the screen, please?
The fact is, we had four dead Americans. Was it because of a protest, or was it because of guys out for a walk one night who decided they'd go kill some Americans? What difference at this point does it make? It is our job to figure out what happened and do everything we can to prevent it from ever happening again, Senator.
Mr. Hicks, could I give you the opportunity to respond to that question? What difference does it make?
I think the question is, what difference did it make?
Yep.
President Magariaf was insulted in front of his own people, in front of the world. His credibility was reduced. His ability to lead his own country was damaged. He was angry. A friend of mine who ate dinner with him in New York during the UN season told me that he was still steamed about the talk shows 2 weeks later. And I definitely believe that it negatively affected our ability to get the FBI team quickly to Benghazi.
So this false labeling was a spontaneous reaction to a video, was a direct contravention of the explanation offered by this president of Libya. And the facts on the ground impact our ability to investigate the crime scene afterward. How long was it, as you said, before the FBI was allowed access into Benghazi to examine that crime scene?
17 days.
Was the crime scene secured during that time?
No, it was not.